The great thing about our universe is that it's full of stuff. We've got atoms, galaxies, and rays of light. I mean, it could have been empty, and instead we have this incredible universe. But how did it get this way, arranged into particles and star systems and giant spirals of stars? At all different scales, the key to the structure of the universe is the way it vibes. From the insides of atoms to the arms of galaxies, vibrations give rise to some of the most mind-blowing structures in our universe. The universe vibes because lots of things have what's called a natural frequency, or sometimes more than one. You can think of a natural frequency as the frequency an object likes to vibrate at. For instance, if you blow over the top of a bottle or pluck a guitar string, it'll vibrate and make a sound that's dominated by one specific fundamental frequency. That's its natural frequency, and it's determined by the object's physical properties. When objects get a regular push or pull near their natural frequency, they'll start vibrating. And that's called resonance. But a vibration doesn't have to be a sound. It can be any back and forth motion or oscillation. For example, a swing always takes the same amount of time to go back and forth. If you're pushing a child on a swing and the swing comes back to you 30 times a minute, that's its natural frequency. And as you give it a push each time it reaches the top of its arc, the swing goes higher and higher thanks to resonance. In this video, we're talking about vibrations and resonance all over the universe and the incredible ways these simple phenomena play out. Back before there were galaxies and stars and star systems, the universe started out as a hot soup made of fundamental particles. And things were pretty smooth at first. Nothing was clumped up or lopsided. And we know this because today, nearly 14 billion years later, we can still see a snapshot of that early universe. It's called the cosmic microwave background, or the CMB, and it's this faint glow that radiates from every point in the sky. This glow originated during the Big Bang. It stretched out as space expanded, and today it falls to Earth as microwave radiation. One of the first things astronomers noticed about the CMB was that there didn't seem to be any features to it. All they could see was a faint, uniform glow. But looking at it with more sensitive telescopes revealed that it's not completely smooth. Some sections are ever so slightly warmer or cooler than others. And this pattern of fluctuations is an imprint of some of the universe's first ever vibrations, the first sign of structure that emerged when the universe was just a hot primordial soup. Back then, there were particles of light called photons and a mishmash of subatomic particles, including protons, neutrons, and electrons. Within just a few seconds, some of those protons and neutrons joined together to form atomic nuclei, but it was too hot for the electrons to settle down into atoms, so they stayed loose. As they whizzed around, they scattered photons like pinballs, making it impossible for light to really get anywhere. And meanwhile, those same electrons were tugging on the protons and nuclei around them. That created a link between the photons and the particles, with the electrons as the middlemen. The whole mix flowed together like a single fluid. But within that fluid, there were some competing forces. As photons pinged against other particles, they created an outward push known as radiation pressure. The other particles had mass, so they created a gravitational force pulling inward. This set up a little tug of war. Gravity pulled matter together, increasing the density in some regions, but as density increased, collisions between photons and matter also increased, and radiation pressure from those collisions pushed matter back outward. As this fluid made of matter and photons repeatedly squeezed and stretched, it created a spring-like oscillation. This vibration, this squeeze and stretch, kept going for a few hundred thousand years. At that point, things had cooled enough for the free electrons to get captured by nuclei. Once they were tied up in atoms, those electrons stopped scattering photons, and the photons broke free. Suddenly, matter was no longer bound to light. And with that, the oscillations ended. But the ripples from that tug of war got frozen in place. Regions that were being squeezed when the oscillations ended were slightly hotter. The regions that were being stretched were slightly cooler. And that created the pattern of warmer and cooler sections we see imprinted on the CMB today. Over time, matter in those denser areas came together under the force of gravity and collapsed into stars and galaxies. So stuff rather than soup. Today, the distribution of galaxies in the universe aligns with the warmer sections of the CMB, revealing that those early microscopic vibrations in our baby universe became the seeds of galaxies. Today, those galaxies themselves are some of the most incredible examples of structure in the universe, especially the spiral ones. Astronomers don't completely understand how spiral galaxies form, but one leading idea is that the spiral arms are kind of an oscillation, a vibe, if you like, known as a density wave. Density waves themselves are pretty ordinary. If you've ever hit the end of a slinky and watched a wave run through it, you've seen a density wave. It's like a little pinch that travels through some medium, even though no physical thing is moving from one end to the next. Astronomers think that spiral arms are basically a galactic version of this. They're just parts of the galaxy that have gotten scrunched up enough to pop out a bunch of new stars, and then will relax again as the wave passes through. Scientists aren't sure what exactly triggers these waves in the first place, but they think part of the reason the spiral structure holds its shape is because of how various oscillations in the galaxy sync up. Because the density waves aren't the only oscillations happening. Even though stars look like they're fixed in place, they're actually constantly orbiting the center of their galaxy. And as stars go around and around, they do a little dance. They move in and out as other stuff orbiting the galaxy pulls on them. And that little dance has its own frequency. In spiral galaxies, that frequency often matches the amount of time between density waves. And that's not a coincidence. What happens is, every time a density wave passes, it tugs on the star. And when that tug aligns with the in and out motion of the star, it reinforces it. Think of the swing set example, where the swing goes higher and higher as you give it a regular push. That's exactly what astronomers think is happening in spiral galaxies. In a galaxy, that periodic tug caused by the density wave eventually nudges the star into an in and out pattern that's a multiple of the wave's period, or the amount of time it takes the wave to go around the galaxy once. Like the swing set scenario, this is an example of resonance. And resonances with the density waves help sync up the galaxy so that it keeps its overall shape, even as individual stars go in and out of the arms. So a spiral galaxy both forms and stays a spiral, even though everything in it is moving. Now, if you zoom way in on one of these spiral galaxies and look at a single star system, chances are you'll find even more objects moving in sync. For instance, here in our solar system, Pluto makes 2 orbits for every 3 orbits of Neptune. Similarly, every time Jupiter's moon Ganymede makes 1 orbit, its fellow moon Europa makes exactly 2, while Io makes 4. And whole groups of asteroids have orbital periods that are perfectly synced with Jupiter's. And we're not special. Around the galaxy, some planetary systems are even more synced up. A system of exoplanets known as the TRAPPIST system has at least 7 planets whose orbital periods are nearly whole number ratios of each other. And if that doesn't seem amazing, remember, these systems all started out as a hot mess of swirling matter that somehow turned into planets and moons that politely do-si-do around their star. And once again, these patterns form because of the way things vibe. As objects move around their star, they tug on each other at different points. And whenever an object experiences a tug, its orbit changes a little. It might gradually shrink or widen or change shape, and this changes the orbit's frequency. Now, orbital mechanics can get pretty messy pretty quickly, so we won't get into all the details here, but to make a long story short, what happens is this. Over time, 2 nearby bodies will often pull each other into orbits whose frequencies reinforce each other. In other words, they're in resonance. They give each other a tug at just the right moment to reinforce each other's motion, just like if you push the swing right when it reaches the top of its arc. When this happens, orbits that had been stretching or shrinking suddenly lock into place. This is called resonance capture. Once 2 satellites are in this configuration, it can be hard for them to get out. If one object starts to move out of the resonant orbit, the resonant object will naturally hold it back or pull it forward a little until it falls back into resonance. And this is one big reason why planetary systems settle into such organized places. But these cosmic vibes aren't just structuring stuff out in space. Even at a subatomic level, resonant vibrations underpin the world as we know it. Just like a swing set or a planetary system, atoms and molecules have natural frequencies based on their structure. Inside them, electrons whiz around the nucleus in specific orbitals. You can imagine an orbital as being kind of like a story in a building. You have a ground level, and then you have a bunch of other levels above that. Electrons occupy different energy levels depending on how much energy they have. And electrons can move between orbitals if they gain or lose exactly the right slight amount of energy, like when they come into contact with light. Light is an electromagnetic wave that jiggles charged particles back and forth. And every different color of light has a different frequency, which also corresponds to a different amount of energy. Certain colors have just the right amount of energy to bump an electron to a higher orbital. When this happens, it means the frequency of the light is one of the natural frequencies of the atom. And meanwhile, any time an electron drops down from a higher orbital to a lower one, it releases light. And once again, that light has a specific frequency that corresponds to the difference in energy between two orbitals. All the colors we see in the universe come from light being absorbed or emitted by atoms and molecules. For example, leaves are green because they absorb everything except green light. If it weren't for resonant vibrations, the interactions between light and matter that give the world its color just wouldn't happen. Our whole universe would be colorless. Now, if we drill down to the tiniest building blocks of our universe, we'll find particles. And even those owe their existence to vibrations. Because particles, despite being the tiniest things out there, are actually not the most fundamental thing. As best as theoretical physicists can understand, particles themselves emerge from what are called fields. You can think of a field as a kind of fluid that is spread all throughout the universe. Fields have a specific value at every point in space. A magnetic field is one familiar example of this. You can't feel a magnetic field yourself, but if you look at how iron filings orient themselves around a magnet, you can see that there is something permeating space that is telling those filings how to orient themselves. That's the value of the field at that location. And there are all kinds of fields in the universe. In fact, every single fundamental particle we know about today has a corresponding field. And in any field, the values can change over time. For the most part, those fields have a value close to zero. You can think of these fields as a calm surface of a pond sitting pretty flat. But sometimes they get jiggled a little. And to understand what happens when a quantum field gets jiggled, let's stick with the pond analogy for a second. When raindrops fall into a pond, they create ripples spreading outward from each drop. And those ripples are little oscillations. In this case, they cause the water to move up and down. When a quantum field gets jiggled, it also creates an oscillation, and that oscillation moves through the field like a ripple. As that ripple passes, the values of that field oscillate around their zero point, just like water bobbing up and down with a wave. That little jiggle that the field does is known as an excitation. It's the thing that carries energy around a field, and that's something we know better as a particle. So particles themselves are essentially vibrations of a field. But here's where the similarity with a ripple in a pond ends. Because that excitation in a quantum field doesn't look like a regular wave. In a lake, if you drop tinier and tinier rocks in the water, you will always get ripples. They'll just get smaller and smaller. But in a quantum field, if you don't jiggle it just the right amount, you will barely get any ripple at all. The field will just stay flat. And that's because this is the realm of quantum mechanics. So everything is quantized. In other words, values aren't continuous. Everything comes in chunks, and there's no in between each chunk. It's similar to how light falling on an atom has to have just the right wavelength in order to bump an electron up to a higher energy level. A quantum field needs to receive just the right amount of jiggle to get excited and create a particle. In other words, that jiggle has to match the natural frequency of the field. So the properties of each quantum field, the ways in which they resonate, are what define the properties of the particles that emerge from them. Now, as for how you jiggle a quantum field in the first place, well, different fields can do that to each other. Not all fields interact with each other, but some are closely related, so a jiggle in one can set off a jiggle in another. And what you end up with is a never-ending collection of vibrating fields that creates all of the stuff in the universe. So from beginning to end, from the most fundamental to the most complex, resonant vibrations underlie the structure of the universe as we know it. And there are lots of wonders to behold, from immense to tiny. For example, much of North America will be experiencing a total solar eclipse on April 8th, 2024. Those only happen in specific locations once a century or so. So if you're in the path of totality, from southwestern Mexico all the way up past Dallas, Detroit, and Toronto, you do not want to miss out on this one. And you won't if you order our SciShow eclipse glasses, which are safety certified by folks whose safety opinions matter and will let you look at the sun during the eclipse without hurting your eyes. Thanks for watching this video.